So I got involved in smart growth and redevelopment a while ago, working on something called Atlantic Station. After 15 years in Atlantic Station, coming right into the teeth of the Great Recession in the fall of 2008, we realized that maybe a change was needed. And I wanted to make the change on my own terms, not on the economy's terms. And the Atlanta Beltline, which is Atlanta's biggest redevelopment project since Reconstruction, had a vacancy in its leadership, and I went ahead and went after it and convinced the folks to hire me, and it's been about 3 years since. Atlanta Beltline Inc. Arguably has the best project in the country right now, and what we're doing is we're taking four historic freight rail lines that used to encircle the city to bypass congestion on those freight rail lines. We're reconnecting them into a contiguous loop 22 miles around for new light rail streetcar transit, connecting 45 different neighborhoods throughout the city, our most affluent and our least affluent, but also then providing 1,300 acres of new parks, 40 miles of new multi-use trails, over 5,000 units of affordable housing, a major arts program, a jobs training program, an urban agriculture program, and mixed-use development all along. It came out of a master student's thesis. He had a simple idea: let's take four old freight rail lines and reconnect them for transit and sit on top of our existing heavy rail infrastructure, which is MARTA. Our subway system is known as the Metropolitan Atlanta Rapid Transit Authority. So MARTA sits kind of in a cardinal point layout, north, south, east, and west, but doesn't connect to a lot of neighborhoods. And that was his simple idea: let's connect neighborhoods in a loop using old freight rail lines to the MARTA system. So he happened to be giving this presentation at some neighborhood event, and the city council president at the time heard this. And she said, this is exactly what we need to be doing. We need to get out and start tomorrow. So she grabbed this graduate student, his name's Ryan Gravel, and brought him into the mayor's office. And the mayor at the time was Shirley Franklin, and she had just been elected, and she had a $4 billion sewer problem. And that's all she could focus on. She said, great idea, love it, but come back when I have time to focus on something other than sewers. So 2 years later, they did come back, but in those 2 years, they went neighborhood by neighborhood, 45 neighborhoods strong, talking about this idea. The end of 2 years, 45 neighborhoods had endorsed this officially and had sent a request to the mayor to do this. So the public has embraced the Atlanta Beltline. We have 30,000 people who have opted in to get weekly updates from us. We have over 1,500 volunteers who man festivals and do information campaigns and are out there actually part of our speakers bureau. We have volunteers who are talking about what we're doing. So inherently, you know, we're just stewards of what the public has been dreaming about, their future vision of their city. And so the support's fantastic. So the city has a unique experience on public-private partnerships. Both the private sector and the public sector come together to tackle big challenges. And the Atlanta Beltline, by anyone's measure, is a big challenge. I mean, it's a $4 billion project, 22 miles of rail, 40 miles of trail, 1,300 acres of parks. You know, these things add up. You know, $750 million of just completing streets, you know, missing sidewalks, things like that. So the mayor at the time, Shirley Franklin, convened a public-private task force to figure out how do we do this. And so she was supportive because she had figured out how to deal with the sewers, number one, and now was focused on not just fixing things, but building plans for the future. And so this task force created a 501c3 nonprofit called the Atlanta Beltline Partnership. Out of the Atlanta Beltline Partnership, which is chaired by CEOs throughout the city, whether it's a Home Depot or UPS or Coca-Cola, they recognize the need for a special purpose entity, thus Atlanta Beltline Inc., the organization I work for. We are the developer of the Atlanta Beltline. Our job is to secure the right-of-way, the land itself, to design, engineer, construct, and operate it. And so ever since then, it's been the single biggest plan and project underway, but for the International Airport, by both Mayor Franklin and now Mayor Kasim Reed. What we've realized is the Atlanta Beltline as a concept and as a specific project was needed 30 years ago. And so we're trying to respond to something that people have been yearning for. You know, Atlanta is a city of neighborhoods, but at the same time, it's a city that really grew up after World War II. And as you know, the smart growth movement has been dealing with America growing up after World War II behind the wheel of a car going 35 miles an hour. And so Atlanta's disconnected in many ways. And Atlanta's growing. The city of Atlanta's population today in 2012 is at its highest ever in the history of the city. Significant because from 1946 to 1996, we lost population every year. So for 50 years of straight population decline, we've caught that back up in basically 16 years. Projections by our Metropolitan Planning Organization say that within the next 20 or so years, we're going to add another 250,000 people. That's a 50% increase just to the city limits alone. The region's going to add 3 million more people. That's basically the entire metropolitan area of Denver, every man, woman, and child vacating Denver and moving to the Atlanta region. So we're going to continue to grow. We're going to continue to have mobility challenges. And so already, the Atlanta Beltline is serving a significant need for connections for trails, multi-use trails. We're underparked. The city of Atlanta is one of the most underparked cities in the country. And the whole parks per capita measure that kind of gives us that distinction is only going to get worse for us as this population continues and the footprint doesn't change. So we're seeing already neighborhoods that were underparked receiving parks that we're building and development happening around it and giving them their kind of community living rooms. So that's how we're seeing that people want this now. I mean, the fact that 30,000 people and growing are signing up weekly to hear more about this. They're coming out on the trails. We had 700 people come to a skateboard park opening. You know, we've had, you know, universal support and enthusiasm from the neighborhoods at the most local level. Yeah, public policy is something we're having to overcome, I think, globally. I mean, the idea of planning or environmentalism was probably considered in the same breath as communism not that long ago in places in the South. It's, you know, kind of perceived as a top-down approach. And what we try to do, the Atlanta Beltline inherently is good business. The city of Atlanta is growing by population. The city of Atlanta needs to grow its tax base. You grow tax base by either new development or appreciation. So on the appreciation side, we want to be careful that we don't economically displace those people who have been waiting for new investment in the neighborhoods. But at the same time, you know, the Atlanta Beltline is already spurring development. $20 million of new tax dollars are being created every year based on the work we've done right now. And that's going to go up, up, up. For instance, there was an old 2 million square foot brick Sears Roebuck catalog fulfillment center, warehouse, and department store that sat on the Atlanta Beltline that was, in all intents and purposes, vacant. It was on the city's books, generating zero in tax dollars, costing the city close to $1 million a year to keep the lights on, the rats out, and to keep it from burning down. We got a problem, though. The bottom floors of that building flooded because 50 years ago, the city put a creek in a small pipe. And on a beautiful day when it's not raining, wasn't an issue, but in Atlanta, we have these thunderstorms. And so whenever that happened, the creek would come out of its pipe, would flood downhill and end up in the basement of this building. So the city had a 2 million square foot building generating zero in taxes, costing close to $1 million a year on the Atlanta Beltline. We came in, built a new 17 acre park, built a 2 acre lake within that park, took all those floodwaters from that creek, actually daylit the creek, brought the creek back to viewing, you know, people could actually see it. We then helped sell that building for $27 million. They're now spending, the developers are spending $300 million on that one building, gonna do shops, restaurants, loft office, loft condo, apartments, and a hotel. And then within the next 5 years, we're going to be able to issue a $30 million bond loan on the new property taxes from that building. That is good business. That is private investment following public investment in infrastructure and green space and transit. And then in turn, us being able to generate more income and revenue out of that for the city and for this project. Yeah, the Atlanta Beltline is inherently replicable. We are open source. We make a point of having folks come in from around the country, giving them the tour, opening our books, showing them our contracts, how we've negotiated this, how we're negotiating that, because we found, you know, it's a very small world and it's only getting smaller. And so while the Atlanta Beltline's $4 billion price tag or 22-mile footprint may be overwhelming, and some people may say, well, we don't have that, we're doing it in pieces. So, you know, this is probably a controversial thing to bring up, but there's a gentleman who was a prolific builder in New York. Books have been written about him, and he was kind of controversial at the time, Robert Moses. But he had a quote that makes a lot of sense. And he said, if you're brave enough to drive a stake in the ground, very few are brave enough to pull it out. And that was the Atlanta Beltline's challenge 3 years ago, is that it was long on vision. And we had plenty of renderings talking about this, you know, perfect nirvana in the future with transit and parks and trails and all this wonderful mixed-use development, but we hadn't done anything yet. And so what we did is we broke it up into pieces, bite-sized pieces, a park here, a mile of trail there, a remediated site over here, a new development around the corner. You know, down payment assistance for affordable housing spread throughout the whole corridor. And so by doing that, we're giving people bite-sized pieces that they can actually consume, claim ownership of, and demand more of. And so we've kind of stoked the hunger for what this thing is. And so it's absolutely replicable, it's exportable, and we'd be more than happy to have anyone come visit us and we'll share our story. The federal policy, I think, is evolving around things like the Atlanta Beltline. And the Atlanta Beltline, or modern or local streetcar, is a fairly new concept for mass transit. I think Portland and Seattle have kind of shown us the way. Portland had to do it privately to make it work, because federal policy around transit has historically been about moving people over long distances, primarily during the morning and evening commute. So what we found, which is the same, you know, model we used to build our interstate highways. So what we found is that isn't necessarily kind of the best return on investment. What we're finding in places like Seattle, where they built the South Lake Union streetcar, is that that small little section connecting a redeveloping corridor to the central business district ended up incentivizing people like Amazon to build $1 billion of headquarters and relocate it along that line. And so federal policy is shifting, I think, to support smaller transit connections, kind of adding the connective tissue to a regional backbone, focusing on the transit-oriented development side of transit as well is just as important. So for instance, the Atlanta Beltline, we did a 16,000 acre master plan, a half a mile on either side of our transit corridor throughout the city. It's one of the largest redevelopment master plans in the country. We did that because if we put a transit station in but realized that a neighborhood had blocks and blocks without sidewalks, be really hard to convince someone to do anything other than get in a car and go someplace. That also being said, we had a transit station, but we had sidewalks, but then warehouses, you know, the transit would never be as successful. And so the land use side of the land use transportation balance is just as important as where the train goes and how fast it goes and what the color of the car is. And so that's one thing that I think policy has definitely lagged, because in many ways the federal government wants to stay out of local land use control. But one of the biggest impacts on a successful transportation system, whether it's roads or rail, is the accessory and combining land uses that are in the corridor. So I think we're seeing that happen. Kind of the rules that have now been released regarding new starts on the FTA standpoint is supportive of the things that we do. It's vital that LOCUS and Smart Growth America is out there, that people understand and it's visible about the work and conversations that are going on, because with the way things work in Washington, if you're not in the game, you're not in the game. If you're not there, if you're not communicating, you're not on the Hill and in these meetings and talking to people, you know, it doesn't matter how many letters you might send from where you are. You have to be here kind of on the streets and pressing the flesh, so to speak. So we're here to kind of, you know, talk and share best practices across our own business platforms, our own experiences, but then also to be a unified force, hopefully force of nature, as we go to talk to our representatives and leadership on the Hill and at the federal agencies and even at the White House about what's important and what generates a really good return on the federal government's investment. There are a lot of things the federal government can do. First and foremost is get out of the way, right? Is to recognize where the right investment in transportation and infrastructure, the right investment in terms of new market tax credits or redevelopment tax credits, where those work, what incentivizes the best return, meaning something that will generate, you know, less of an impact on the local government while also kind of bringing the tide up. So that's kind of the first thing. The second, the biggest thing, I think, the federal government's been giving away money for 60 years as it relates to transportation on a matching basis. The historic match has been federal government gives 80 cents to the dollar if the local government comes in with 20 cents. They've been doing that forever. That's been the model. We're out of money. Okay, that's ending. And it should. The federal government should loan money. Loan money at very favorable rates. You know, the full faith credit of the federal government can bring rates down to 1% or less. Get the money back. Loan it out, get it back. So an infrastructure bank, that kind of thing, whether it's TIFIA, whatever you want to call it, give it a different acronym. But that would be vital. So the Atlanta Beltline, we actually have tax increment financing bonds that we had to go place in the market. We were the first bond issuance post Lehman's collapse in 2008. And, you know, we're paying 7.5%. You know, that is a crazy number to be paying the federal government, instead of giving us money, could credit enhance our ability to loan money, and we got that down to 1% or less, we're talking tens or hundreds of millions of dollars going right back into the ground, creating jobs, building places that are sustainable.